Congratulations, by the way, for winning the National Award Special Mention in 2019. A huge round of applause for everybody.
Thank you.
I think the audience also will agree that this is a very nice, important film. In a day and age where people are obsessed about complaining of not receiving resources, saying that, you know, we want more, there's a sort of greed also that people have, and we don't get a lot of resources also in our cities. You find someone like this living such a simple life without any complaints and without any judgment also. She's sort of just like, I'll live my life and I'll live it the way I want to. How did you find such a theme and character like Hema?
Actually, I have to make a documentary, like part of my curriculum. So at that time I was searching for subjects, but how did I found it is a very long answer. It might take more than 15 minutes. So like, but when I got to know that, I got the first information as she's a 35-year-old woman, not using electricity. She's a teaching somewhere. So from that information, we searched without any, only we know the name, and that's it, 35-year-old. So with that thing, we searched in Pune, and finally we got a chance to meet her. So yeah, in future, maybe I'll make a documentary, How Did I Found Her?
Yeah, I think that will also be an interesting story to tell. I was watching the film and I really was wondering, you know, it's a 12-minute film and we find out about the fact that she's living without electricity at around the 9th minute. So that's like 3/4 of the film done and then you're finding out about that. Could you speak a little bit more about that decision to place that information to the audience at that?
So the thing is, why I wanted to make a documentary on her is, she's not using electricity, the basic thing. That is only, like everybody, that is only triggered me. So when I met her, I felt that, like, electricity is just part of her life. It is not everything. So whoever now meeting her after, now she's little famous in India, I guess. So actually everybody meeting, they're recognizing only this thing, this fact. She is not using electricity. But for me, it is not that. It is just some part of her life. So I thought it should be come like that only. Like her philosophy is more bigger than what she is doing. So that is the thing we chose to keep it on. And yeah.
And I think it really works brilliantly. You find her, this character, with like a wealth of experience, with a wealth of knowledge. She's done so much, she's written so much. And more than that, we also see through the film that she's just at so much ease with you. You know, there's not one frame where you feel like, you know, the camera is intruding over there or something. She's doing her own work. She's just sitting, continuing with her thing. How was the process of shooting with her? Like, and how was the process of, you know, convincing her that this is, you're going to make a film and she's going to be part of it?
So when I met her at the first time, so I didn't tell that I'm going to make a documentary on her or anything. So just I met, ma'am, I don't know about you. So I wanted to make some film. I got to know about you. That's why I was curious. So I came and I met you like that. And after day by day, like whenever I getting time, so I used to go there and I used to meet her. So then one day I told that, ma'am, like I'm a FTI student. She I know that she's a teacher once upon a time. So ma'am, I'm a student. So if we make we need to do some assignment. If you cooperate us, we'll get more marks. So that it will help us. Like that, we told her. So she cooperated with that, being a teacher. So every day, me and my team, like my cinematographer, so we used to go with camera. So that she used to use with the camera, the thing. Whenever we go and meet her, at that time, camera is a third person for her. So it is not a new thing. So she used to that. And you know, when it comes to documentary, I personally don't like staging. That is the my thing. So I don't want to stage it. So whatever she is doing, I wanted to capture those things only. And she is very used to it, and she doesn't care, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She cares about anything.
Yeah, that is the main thing.
Yeah, that's so brilliant.
great. Just to mention, we also have the editor of the film, Farida, in the audience.
And my cinematographer also, Ravi. Naitik. Naitik also, my sound person also is there. Everybody is, luckily everybody is.
I have something which you could answer, and perhaps the editor could join in as well. You sort of start, she's, actually you don't start. We hear the entire story from her. Most of it is from her. There's very little bit of interjection from the filmmaker. And she starts off with such a beautiful way of telling a story. And that starts off such a good tone for the entire film. And throughout the film, there are these other shorter, minor stories. And it's not like they're heavy, deep stories. Sometimes it's just a joke, or sometimes it's just a fact. And then even towards the end, she's sharing a joke with you. Were these conscious decisions that you did, like, you know, that you would put, that you would string together these smaller stories and make a larger narrative?
Actually, when we are shooting, we don't know the structure. We went there and we shot everything. So when we are editing, we know that, like, our biggest struggle is shrinking down to 12 minutes, because we have to make only in 12 minutes only. It is my initial rule. So there we had a problem with, like, what to remove. Everything is good. Every word is good. So removing is the very difficult for us. So really my editor helped us. And it is, we edited in only 7 days, the entire film. We had 14 hours of footage. Though we didn't watch 5 to 7 hours of footage, yeah, that is another thing. But yeah, so yeah, like structuring, like in the opening also, if you see, she tells a story about a shirtless man. If you see the end, she tells about a Adam and Eve joke, who doesn't wear clothes. I felt like it is a like loop circle, like when we are coming towards the like beginning of the.
And it works really, really beautifully. I'm going to steal him for one more question, and then I'm going to throw it out to the audience. The fact that there is no light, you know, filmmaking, photography, etc., relies so much on light. What sort of challenges and how did you overcome, like, shooting somebody where, you know, there's no light and you can't sort of amp that up?
Actually, initially we thought that we might use some LEDs, but later we decided that okay, it might be goes to against our philosophy. If you use any sort of lights, definitely our philosophy. So my cinematographer did great job there, actually. Like, it is like for cinematographers, you know, like light is the basic thing for them. So ignoring that, and they're keeping the subject in the dark and whatever, like, and we are not did any staging. So at that time, it was really difficult. But yeah, like most of the, sometimes I haven't seen frames also. I was talking with them. He managed with that, yeah.
And he's done a really good job. Thanks, Ravi. I'll throw it out to the audience now. Does anyone have some questions there? Could you have the mic?
Actually, it's really great to see her right now again, because I've been several times encountering this person. But there's just two things that I wanted to tell you about. As you said, electricity is just part of the philosophy. Greater philosophy was the way she was living and how materialistically she was, like, giving no damn to those things. But I just wanted to, like, two things was, one, there is this kind of a wilderness within the surroundings where she lives, and the way that she thinks and the way that she lives herself and keeps her surroundings. And I think that your movie has actually captured that, and it's really great. And I can't think of a better title than Glowworm in a Jungle, but it is truly a glowworm, even though it's actually an irony, but I think the title have conveyed it. So it's more of like a suggestion, opinion. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
People can sort of imagine living without electricity, but they usually imagine it in remote places or somewhere where you sort of sign off and you're like, I'm doing this alternate lifestyle. But she's managed to pull this off in the midst of a city, and that is a very, very difficult to do when you're surrounded. Sorry, I stole your
life. I wanted to continue that. Actually, our faculty also asks when you make a documentary that, why are you making a documentary, Anar? So everybody, like mostly in urban cities or in towns, people think that after becoming 60 or 70, we'll go to countryside and we build a small house and we will live there. But she proved that living in with inside the city also you can live however you wanted to. So I don't have that guts to live like that, so that's why I made a film.
So one moment that stood out for me was when the clock, right? And that's also technology, and obviously she must be using batteries for the clock. And then also the fact that she's got a book printed, and a book gets printed in a printing press, which is also technology. So did you have a chance to talk to her about that? Because there is not a full denial of then.
Yeah, if you see, there is some polythene covers
also. Okay. The plastic boxes also, yeah. Did you ask her about technology? Okay.
By naturally, whatever, with her knowledge, whatever she could, right? She's doing her best. So yeah. I don't want to
ask her about that. Okay. Okay, sure. Okay.
I feel like she's not ignoring her surroundings, but she's very well aware of where she's situated and how she goes about her things. And it's the idea that she does not believe in that idea of exotic nature or like the pristine nature, I feel. Like even when she says this plant is named that and that, how does that matter? Even the bird that she recognizes is not a tailor bird, it's a sunbird, but fuck that. And yeah, it's not simple, like it's complex, that she recognizes the complexity and lives in it. And well done portraying it. Thank you.
One thing I felt was that, it's okay to live in a remote area, like you said, but having never been exposed to the conveniences, let's call it. But the fact that she was a faculty and she's a PhD, so on and so forth, she would have been exposed to all those conveniences. And then to render it irrelevant and come back to where she was.
Yeah. So yeah, it is even more difficult. That's what more interesting thing. Kind of in urban city, and she's living, it is a Budwar place in Pune. So it is a most crowded place in Pune. So in that space, she's living like that kind of thing.
Hi. It's a great film, I loved it. Thanks for making this. Sound designing is very interesting part for me. It's the sound designing sets the whole mood for the film, the simplicity, that everything. Mano, how did you do that? Sound design?
Yeah, sound design.
First of all, we found that she's in the middle of the city and she's completely careless of the surroundings and whatever happening there. So basically, there's no light, there's no noise for her. Even though she's listening to many noise, her life is silent, very slow, sometimes dark, sometimes lit by sun, like that. So we wanted that silence of her life in this film. So we tried to the maximum possible thing to avoid all unnecessary noise and bring what she feels. That's the approach. Yeah. And we concentrated on the small sound elements which is happening in that house, even the clock ringing sound. Anything?
How did you do that? I mean, did you used to go with the team and record the location sound?
Yeah, definitely. Everything is in sync. And we have used only one mic, even though we are allowed to use several mics. One just single mic is...
Even to the location ambience?
Yeah, everything.
Amazing job.
Thank
you. On that note, do you want to talk a little bit about how you as a team go to sort of record this inner space, which is so limited? How did you all sort of go?
Like in terms of sound?
Sound and light.
Okay. So actually, we know the fact that before making the film, also we used to go to her entire team, four members. So we used to go and meet her. At that time, we thought that she is very used to us. So it is better that on shoot day also only if we attend, then it will be good. But our institute throws entire light departments to us, but we convinced them to stay outside only. And main thing, we didn't actually, for that camera is heavy, and for sound equipment, he need a boom man, and he has a recorder. So, but the sound man did both the things alone, because we don't want to bring other person. And the camera person, he had only one assistant. And major thing is, nobody knows Marathi, the entire team. The camera assistant knows Marathi. So if there is anything comes on that moment, so we took him, I guess, one day earlier to her, and we introduced him to her. Then she is a little bit used to him. Yeah, so we are very isolatedly, small. That.
With questions?
I was just curious because the paint area in Pune is in itself a very rich aesthetic experience, and it can feel very confined. But in the movie, throughout the movie, I could not, if I were to sit down and draw what the schematic of her house would be like or how big or small that place is, I can't. And I feel like what that does is it gives me this experience of a limitless space, which is exactly what it is in her head, where she's living. And I would really want to give you kudos for that. It was beautiful. And my question to you actually is that if you actually sit on a chait or in Pate or in a small area, you will meet at least two or three. In Pate, if you sit in a chait apri or in a place where they serve their vadas, you will meet at least two or three people like this who are not married, who are in their late 80s and have lived a wonderful, beautiful life. Do you have plans of going back to Pate and kind of documenting more of this? Because I feel like there are so many stories there. Have you thought about that in any sense ever?
Right now, I haven't thought, but I wanted to make a feature-length documentary about Hanar. So right now, I have this plan, but maybe it is a good idea, actually. Maybe I'll make it in future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have time for one more? Just one. Any last question?
I wanted to ask you about your choice of the language. So you started with, she starts talking in English, but at the end she does talk in Marathi. So just curious to know what was the idea behind that decision. Was it because the crew, like you said, were not very good in Marathi? Or was it because she initiated talking in English?
Actually, when we used to communicate with her during our research time also, she used to communicate with her as in English. So I was in dilemma that whether we should go with Marathi or English. So at the end of the day, we decided that let's go with, and we found that her English is a little cute. And so we thought that let's go with this. And it is very comfortable for us also to continue.
Thanks.
All right. I think we've come to the end of our time here, but Ramana and Farida and all of them are here, so please do feel free to ask them any questions. I'd just like to end with a bit from the film where she says, people call me a mad old woman. And then she calls you and says that, you are mad also to be doing this. Please continue to be mad. Please continue to make films like this and take this to other places as well. And a request to the audience as well to be as insane as possible. Thank you.